Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Clotting disorder can be linked to recurrent miscarriages, causing fertility problems for women. But it is still possible for a woman with clotting disorders to get pregnant and give birth to a healthy babies. To enlighten us on the topic fertility and pregnancy prospects in women predisposed to thrombosis, I would like to invite our esteemed speaker, Dr. Vivekanand, sir.
Dr. Vivekanand is currently consultant vascular surgeon and head of department, Jain Institute of Vascular Sciences, also consultant vascular surgeon, Sagar Apollo Hospital, and member of Karnataka Medical Council, Vascular Society of India, Diabetic Foot Society of India, International Union of Angiology, President Vascular Society of Karnataka. He is a forum convener of Wound Healing Forum Bangalore. His areas of interest include prevention of diabetic foot infections and limb loss, increasing awareness about DVT and other thrombotic events. Over to you, sir.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. As a vascular surgeon, attending a purely medical meet like this is a little intimidating, hearing so much of science going on over here. Looking at this topic beginning itself, you know, made me sweat a little. For surgeons, especially vascular surgeons, you know, this sounds like Greek and Latin. So I called up Dr. Kamini and asked, what do you want me to talk? Then finally I decided, okay, listen, you get the lady pregnant. So we thought, you know, let's go towards prevention of DVT happening in our patients who are prothrombotic or even normal. So recently I attended a conference that was last week, devoted 1.5 days only towards DVT and pregnancy, where we met all the authors of your RCOG. Things are changing, and what evidence was lacking earlier, evidence is coming into the picture now, and I think, you know, you must all be quite aware about it. If you look at it, you know, each minute one person is diagnosed as having a DVT. That means, you know, if we roughly divide the population of the world between equal men and women, that means once in 2 minutes or once in 2.5 minutes, you have a lady developing DVT. Could be at any stage in her life, but that is the incidence. Now, thrombosis doesn't spare anybody. It doesn't spare anybody, rich or poor, pregnant, non-pregnant. I mean, most recent one was Serena Williams, okay? She had her first DVT with pulmonary embolism, 1996, and then again 2011, postpartum period, she had another DVT with pulmonary embolism, and in some of the best institutes in the world. Again, Hillary Clinton, and I know this person doesn't belong here, Sidhu, and that's Zaza Gabor, who also had DVT and pulmonary embolism. So it can happen to any one of us, or it can happen to any pregnant lady. So what is the risk of DVT? They call it as venous thromboembolism. We most commonly call it as deep vein thrombosis. What is actually the incidence? Might have, you know, you might have seen a lot of patients, and then you say that, you know, it doesn't happen in Indian patients per se as such. So where we stand, we still don't know about Indian data, but there is definitely DVT in pregnancy, because as a tertiary institute, we see a lot of these cases. But again, population-based data not available. So this was the classic paper by Jacobson et al. And look at this, 6,13,232 pregnancies from 1990 to 2003 were studied in different countries, okay? They identified 615 DVT or thromboembolism cases as such, okay? So what did they come up? What did they finally come up with? They said, you know, the incidence is 1.2 for 1,000 pregnancies. So it looks like it's quite less, but looking at the entire population of the country, I'm sure it's there in our country too, because, you know, we are not immune from those conditions what they have. We have equal number of same kind of conditions, which we will see. Again, the same thing, 1 to 1.2. Highest is seen during the delivery time and the immediate post-delivery time. But again, if you extrapolate the time, it's more or less equally spread out. But maximum we see is postpartum DVT is what we see quite a lot. Greatest risk is in the first 6 weeks after delivery, but goes on till 12 weeks. And again, try and prevent it from happening, because if we are good doctors, we prevent DVT from happening. One of those few conditions which can be prevented. The rest of it is all treatment. So if you are surrounded by good physicians, since there is a really complicated decision-making process, it would have been very nice if you had got your physician colleagues also along with you, because you know, you obstetrician gynecologists are like vascular surgeons. You don't have a physician equivalent. So you have to be a physician, a very good physician, as well as a surgeon, as well as a obstetrician. Okay, so your knowledge has to be very, very high, and you have to be at the cutting edge. But if you have a physician along with you who takes care of the fitness part, again, you know, it's, if they had attended, it would have made a lot of sense. It would have reduced your burden. But I think maybe next time you should ask your physicians, your co-colleagues to attend the conference per se as such. Again, why is there DVT during pregnancy? Again, please remember the incidence is very, very less, but still there. Especially people who have undergone IVF are at an increased risk of VTE in the first trimester, with a seven-fold increased risk of pulmonary embolism, especially those receiving estrogen therapy. Okay, so why does this? Especially pregnancy per se as such is one of the risk factor for developing deep vein thrombosis. Though it's a physiological event, it has one mark when it comes to an independent risk factor. It causes hypercoagulability, it causes venous stasis, and then it does cause a little bit of vascular damage. So they are prone. Now, again, you know, what is the similarity between endometrium and endothelium? Endothelium is what we deal with. Okay, so is there any similarity? Yeah, I was looking around. Then I found out, you know, listen, we have common enemies. Okay, who are the common enemies? Smoking. Again, I'll go back to it. You know, at least in our country, the incidence of smoking in pregnancy might not be that very high, but it does exist. Obesity, I'm sure, you know, it prevents your fertility and it might cause DVT. OCPs and the hormone replacement therapy, a tremendous pain, because we see quite a lot of these patients. That's how this discussion started. And then it led to me being called for this conference. Chronic inflammation, any part of the body, chronic inflammation could be your autoimmune conditions. So it makes the endothelium more prone for developing a clot. APLA, you're experts in this. SLE, ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome, PCOS, PPH and preeclampsia, these are the things which I will not talk much about, okay, because my domain knowledge regarding these things are very, very less. But for us, I'll slowly, you know, we always associate deep vein thrombosis or thrombosis with smoking. So even I associate more with smoking. Now we'll slowly start realizing that, you know, there are other important factors which are worse than smoking, that is obesity and immobility. I'll show you the statistics regarding that. Again, not body shaming anybody, because I belong to the same figure. What happens during pregnancy? What happens during pregnancy is the procoagulant factors. Normally, there is a fine homeostasis between the procoagulants and the anticoagulants. We have equal anticoagulants and equal procoagulants. Certain conditions increase the level of procoagulants, may not decrease the level of anticoagulants, but the procoagulant factors go up, and rendering the homeostasis a delicate balance. And addition to those things could be pregnancy, could be autoimmune conditions, could be smoking, immobility. So it makes them a little more prone for developing DVT. Again, all these things have got, vascular surgery does not deal with these things. Okay, we come into the picture only after the clot is formed. Now, all my guidelines I've got from your books, and I've got from RCOG, or from the gynec book. So what does your data tell? Okay, if you look at it, patients who undergone assisted reproductive therapy, ARTs, okay, and the risk of developing DVT and pulmonary embolism. Again, if you look, this is the normalcy. Again, round 1.2. As the time goes on, it increases. But if you look into as ARTs and DVT, the risk is definitely higher. So it is 0.4. There we saw it was 1 or 1.2 per 1,000. Okay, now you have nearing 4 per 1,000. So fourfold increase, especially those who are undergoing ARTs. What methods of ART, I will not be able to comment much on it. You are the experts on it. Again, the risk of pulmonary embolism also marginally goes up. Please don't think all pulmonary embolism results in death. No. Only 10% of them are fatal pulmonary embolism. Majority of them are not. So just because there is DVT, just because there is a pulmonary embolism, doesn't mean that's the end of the story. No, it's not. Okay? Now, OHSS. Again, if you look at this, fresh IVF with OHSS, this is the number of non-VTE pregnancies, this is the number of VTE pregnancies, and the incidence per 1,000 goes up to 16.8. For normal pregnancies, okay, it's 1 or 1.2. With the ARTs, it goes up to around 4. Here, it goes up to 16 per 1,000. It's not 16%. It's 16 per 1,000. But again, you see that, you know, the numbers are going up. So that means the procoagulant levels are going up. So yeah, we'll come to the recommendations per se as such. A little bit about the comorbid conditions or the other things which might cause thrombosis. If you look at this, you know, I was looking at, okay, the next slide will show that, okay. ART 1.8, hyperemesis, you start seeing that, you know, they're 2.5 times, BMI greater than 30 is 5.3, rest of all the things are, okay, manageable, multiple pregnancy 4.2, but look at this. Immobility with BMI greater than 25. A lot of people belong to that. And this is what the risk comes up to. So this somewhere, you know, more than other things, it is this immobility, which you will need for your conditions. So we need, most of our patients, especially the high-risk pregnancies, might need bed rest. So what do we do to prevent DVT from happening there? Because it is needed to. Again, same Jacobson's factor. He looked into antenatal and postnatal causes. Fantastic paper. And if you look at it, the biggest problems, okay? Some of them have an additive effect. Some of them have a multiplicative effect. Again, maximum risk was in BMI greater than 25 and immobilization extremely high. And I was under the impression that it is smoking, you know, causing deep vein thrombosis. But looking at your papers, I found that, you know, being grossly overweight, being overweight, 25 to 30 is considered as overweight. We won't label ourselves as obese. Maybe after 30, we call ourselves obese. But again, this is the kind of multiplicative effect that had and made me start thinking about immobility. And again, postnatal risk factors. That was antenatal risk factors. The same study came up with the postnatal risk, this one. Again, these are the things which had a multiplicative effect. Cigarette smoking, again, 10 to 30 cigarettes, 3.5. Preeclampsia, all these things have a 3 times, 4 times, 6 times effect. But this is where we need to be very, very careful. And vaginal delivery with infection, yes, the risk of DVT increases. Again, not just because of the infection, along with the bed rest, which goes along with it. Now, there are a lot of societies, you know, when we went over there, we found that, you know, there are a lot of societies, all of them working towards DVT and pregnancy. These were some of the things that, you know, we found out. I spoke to quite a few gynecologists, you know, they said, you know, we follow RCOG guidelines. I said, okay, let me restrict myself to RCOG guidelines. But then, you know, there are a lot of other societies also which have come up with. And again, let me be a little provocative and say that, you know, listen, gynecologists don't agree with each other. They're worse than surgeons. No consensus has been found. Even among RCOG guidelines, you know, when we sat with them and when we start discussing, you know, we had this 18-hour session with them. Even among all the people who formed the RCOG guidelines, this was as early as last week, there was no proper consensus per se as such. This was a meeting called for consensus. And again, each one follows a different guidelines. You know, it's nice to quote, okay, we follow RCOG guidelines. Follow some guidelines. Maybe, you know, Indian society has their own guidelines, or you can, but follow some guidelines. Don't selectively pick out data. From this guideline, I'll follow this. For IUGR, I'll follow some other guidelines. No, our knowledge becomes imperfect then. Follow some guidelines. We'll leave it to you. But again, no consensus has been obtained. let me go into the specifics. I'll be a little theory intensive over here. Bear with me. Okay? Now, if you look into it, okay, reducing the risk of very, very detailed analysis has been done. Okay? Now, if a patient is asymptomatic thrombophilia, what do we mean by asymptomatic thrombophilia? That means patient had an earlier DVT. Earlier DVT, at this moment, patient is pregnant, but has no DVT per se as such. Okay? So how do you proceed further? What does the recommendation say? Okay, save your back, get a hematologist in consultation, get a vascular surgeon, whoever is in charge of this, get a consult from them, and they should be recommended 6 weeks postnatal prophylaxis, even in the absence of additional risk factors. I would request a few minutes extra. So this is what is recommended. Okay, does not have existing DVT at this pregnancy. If there is existing DVT, yeah, you need to treat the DVT per se as such. Okay, now this is where it is extremely controversial. All patients having cesarean section should have post-cesarean prophylaxis at least for 10 days. Again, then they started, I'm going by what your guideline says. You know, the lot of people who nod their head saying that, no, it doesn't apply to us. Okay, it says should have an elective cesarean section. If it's an elective cesarean section, maybe yes, maybe no, if you make them mobile early. And if they have additional, if it is an emergency LSCS, and if they have additional, they have to have prophylaxis. Now came American Society of Hematologists. They say, for women undergoing cesarean section without additional thrombosis, we recommend against the use of thrombosis, grade 1B. Okay? Again, there is confusion. So you decide because you know what your patients have. Okay? If you look at the guidelines and start extrapolating it, now, especially RCOG is recommending thromboprophylaxis left, right, and center based on their scoring system. If they have then more than three factors which are positive, and pregnancy itself is one mark over there. Pregnancy itself is this one. So they recommend, RCOG recommends 85% of patients may need prophylaxis, should be considered for prophylaxis. They're not saying document it on the paper. Whether they have it or not, please document it on the paper. ACCP is American College of Chest Physicians, is what we follow as vascular surgeons. We don't go by too many guidelines, and we don't make guidelines, so they make good guidelines. They say 34%. ACOG is like this. And this is the data which has come out from your books per se as such. So ultimately, you know, the patient, you've decided, okay, needs prophylaxis for whatever risk factors. So what is the drug that you give? Vascular surgery is very, very easy. We do not deal with too many drugs. We have 3, 4, 5 drugs which have been there for decades together. Only newer things have come in recently. Okay, low molecular weight heparin or heparin-based compounds can be safely given. Rest of the other drugs, whether it is fondaparinux, not extensively studied. Warfarin, post-delivery, maybe you can consider, definitely. But newer anticoagulants, please don't, not studied. So what are we left with? Back to the good old thing, unfractionated heparin, preferably low molecular weight heparin. Again, all the guidelines say the same thing. Okay, so safest is low molecular weight heparin, and heparin or heparin and associated compounds per se as such. So dosage less than 50 kgs, 20 milligrams daily, 50 to 90, 40 milligrams daily. Most of our patients come in this 40 milligrams daily, and the dosage gradually goes up depending on the body weight per se as such. Where do you not give? We know where to give now. Where do you not give? If she has active bleeding, or if the platelet counts are less, any contraindication towards giving anticoagulation, obviously you do not give anticoagulation. There are a lot of this one. And especially if there is renal disease, because you know, Professor Mani is over here, heparin tends to bioaccumulate in the body. If you have to give, switch over to low molecular weight heparin, tends to accumulate. So adjust the dose along with heparin per se as such. RCOG guidelines, again, not all patients, if there is high risk, You don't have to screen for thrombophilia for all the patients, okay? And even if they screen, they only screen for four elements. One is AT3, protein C, protein S, and MTHFR. Those are the only criteria that they have. Again, APLA is considered separate for them. If the patient has APLA, if the patient has APLA, and if the patient is pregnant, two more slides, two or come. If the patient has is pregnant, has to be given anticoagulation per se as such. Again, hyperemesis, when the patient is admitted with dehydration or hyperemesis, just give IV fluids. OHSS should be considered. IVF pregnancy plus three risk factors, please consider thromboprophylaxis. Post-delivery, if there are risk factors, 10 days, if they have thrombophilia, go on for 6 weeks per se as such. Again, like I told you, I'll come to this. Sometimes has to go on for 6 weeks postpartum. There are drop-down menus which will tell you what are the drugs to be given and how to score these things. Will not go into this. All these things say the same thing. I want to tell you there are a lot of conditions where, you know, you might not be in a position to give low molecular weight heparin for extended duration of time. Let's not think thromboprophylaxis is only medicines. Okay, there are devices which prevent calf veins from accumulating blood. Okay, if the patient is on bed rest, okay, you can consider devices like this. A simple device which you put on the calf region, for whatever reason, if they're on bed rest, make sure that they are prophylaxed. Huntley, Flotron is easily available, but the same thing is available as a mobile device. You can put this on and continue to do your work or continue to be with bed rest. With this, I end my talk. Sorry. Everybody looks at the, this is Nigella Lawson, my favorite cook, and since I'm into cooking, I love this lady, both for her looks as well as skills. If you have to have a good baby like this, okay, there is a lot of things which you need to consider. Everything needs to fall into place. That is when you'll get deliver a good baby. Everybody looks at you smiling and delivering a baby, but the amount of work that you've put in, the amount of knowledge that you guys put into this, each successful delivery, is phenomenal. Thank you, and sorry for the extra time.
That was a very informative and interesting talk, sir. I'm sure we'll all have lots to take back from this session. Thank you so much. Now we'll quickly move on to the next session, session two, keynote addresses. Any
Thank
questions?
For Dr. Prakash Mehta, sir.
Oh, it's for Prakash.
Just a quick question. Sir, could you please let us know, elaborate the role of biomarkers, sir? If you're looking at lupus, how would you, would biomarkers help you differentiate between a flare and preeclampsia?
Yeah, absolutely. Biomarkers would be one of the very important tests that you can do. You have either the SFLT-PLGF ratios, or what we follow currently in the hospital is the maternal serum glycosylated values, which is a point of care test. I get the result in 10 minutes and it's a bedside test. So if the glycosylated values are more than 600, then possibly I'm dealing with a preeclampsia complications. If they are 150 to 250, possibly I'm dealing with a lupus flare. Same thing applies to SFLT-PLGF ratio also. So these have to be used in specific conditions, but yes, they have got a very, very good value. And I mean, I've used it with quite a bit of success.
So can used in these patients to for surveillance for preeclampsia, because they are anyway at a high risk. So can we use them routinely in the third trimester, because you are scared about having preeclampsia and helping them?
Absolutely right, because these are all automatically high risk patients. They're not no longer talking about normal patients and screening tests. Since these patient with lupus may get preeclampsia or may already be hypertensive, these tests definitely have to be used and can be used with a very good outcome. Thank you. Just one more point. I think as obstetricians, when we talk of DVT, we need to tell our patients to drink water, especially patients from North Karnataka and Andhra. The grannies at home do not give them water, and then they come back with DVT. We have had any number of cases like this. So please tell your patient that have enough water. I think if you do that much also, our DVT rates would come down by 50%.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an enlightening session. I would now request our organizing chairperson, Dr. Kamini Rao, to come and please introduce our keynote speakers.
We're now coming into the keynote session, and we have none other than the illustrious Padma Bhushan, Dr. M.K. Mani from Chennai. A big hand, ladies and gentlemen. Renal failure is a challenging clinical problem when it occurs in pregnancy. It requires an understanding of the normal physiology of the kidney in pregnancy and the natural history of different underlined renal diseases when pregnancy occurs. So Dr. Mani, who is the pioneer of nephrology in the country, also could easily be called the father of nephrology, who is now the who will be talking to us on renal dysfunction in pregnancy. Now, I would like to welcome Dr. Mani to be able to give his keynote address. It's been very well acclaimed. His talks are very practical, and with the kind of experience he has, believe me, it is amazing. Thank you very much, Dr. Mani.